become the most high priority mid laner, since we should assume to see Syndra and Ryze permaband. Just because she offers great protection for hyper carries that can shred those tanks. She has great 1v1 individual matchups in the mid lane, and she can actually put out sustained damage over the course of the fight to whittle the tanks down.
Going further in the picks and bans, we have the Karma taken off the board. We already talked about the Syndra being something that has pretty much persisted in power for a while. And there's that Trundle ban on Team Ice's side.
Yeah, already starting to see the meta develop a little bit. Obviously, again, Courage of the Colossus is the new thing in vogue. Trundle works very well against those tank champions that have really started to dominate the top lane. And I especially like to see the respect of Tahm Kench taken away.
You'd normally see that being thought of as a support, but no, you don't. Evie is the one who has been dominating on that one. LeBlanc is the last ban for Japan. And of course, we will see a quick lock-in of Poppy for Helior.
But this does mean that Ryze is still open and available into that mid lane. Now, again, Seraph did take Vel'Koz. He is known as primarily an innovator, but I expect that most mid laners would be able to look through that rotation and find that champion in the wheelhouse.
Yeah, I'll bet that Seraph will want to take the last peek here and get the counter up against Plugo. It's a matchup that definitely should go his way, so he may be fine with just taking a skill-based matchup, and you can see they're focusing more on picking Haredi, something he's comfortable with, getting tussled at Lee Sin.
Okay,
there's the Ryze.
Yeah, we're going quick and fast through this. Key things to point out, we got Haredi on a utility AD carry. Again, Wara is going to be your high mechanical AD carry. Haredi is going to be your utility, so the Ashe fits perfectly for him there. Tussle on the Lee Sin, that's the big thing. This is the guy that you want to watch. He's a very proactive jungler. He is the best jungler in his region, and he's looking across from the best jungler in the Latin America South region in Kleitos. And Kleitos is known for his Rek'Sai. So again, if Tussle is your aggressive jungler, Kleitos is completely the opposite. He's your dandy type of jungler, you know, vision, control oriented.
Yeah, get in, steal something and get out. And buff control is going to be very, very important, I think, in this game. Well, Tussle, true to his name, he does like to get in the thick of it and mix things up with the action. A lot of power, though, with that Ryze that Plugo is taking in the mid lane. And here we go, the Nautilus lock-in for Evie here. Or it could be support. Well, not anymore, because
no.
It's Alistar. Never mind.
It's Dara's Alistar. He is very well known for this back in his region. This is terrifying for him to get his hands on it. And we know, we heard Mithy talking on the desk, you know, why is Vayne not as high of a priority? Mithy was theorizing it's because she has a weak lane phase. The meta is still very much about who can control the lane, especially the creep minions. But if you're opening up more tank supports, if you're bringing in more melee supports like the Alistar, it does give room for Vayne to shine and to find some counterplay and matchup. So Wara has the option here. There's the Janna. I'm looking for the Vayne.
Likely to happen.
Oh,
Ezreal, though, still considered an option. We won't let see if that gets locked in just yet. It does.
The
That's
respect.
A pair. A very safe pick. And Wara is the hyper carry of this team. They're going to want him to be pumping out that damage late, so they're not wanting to put him in any danger early on.
Yeah, talking to the team, they said that they were totally comfortable building around Wara, that they knew his identity going into this tournament. He is the hyper carry of their region. We expected the Vayne to come out because he's very comfortable, but like you said, the respect. You've got Dara on his coveted Alistar pick. You've got the ultimate from Nautilus coming in, as well as the Ash Arrow. You know, he's not going to gamble that many times with that many hard CC, so he looks for the very safe, very self-sufficient pick in Ezreal.
Absolutely. So Japan just shuffling around for a little bit as the last picks come in. Finally, we had that Cassiopeia locked in for Seraph. Cassie versus Ryze. We've seen that one quite a bit.
yeah, and it's going to be mostly about who's going to get the dominant lane shove in there. But before we kind of talk about the mid lane matchup, again, just kind of collectively looking at these compositions, it's still very much about kind of creating area of effect in Latin America south sides and protecting Wara and allowing him to output that crazy amount of damage that Ezreal can do late game. On the other side, it's about your layering CC and having multiple engage options for the LJL.
Absolutely. And if they can land it all, I mean, there's only so many ways to get out of danger. Ryze, Ezreal, those are going to be the big linchpins there for LAS in this 5v5.
But that's a lot of pressure on Plugo, and he is looking across from Seraph, you know, kind of one of the crown jewels of the LJL. He's known as the Faker of Japan, so certainly a tough opponent, and he's going to really need to utilize every facet of Ryze's power to beat that 1v1 matchup in mid.
Yeah, well, they faced off in Assassin's mode already, and, you know, that one went very one-sided towards Japan's way, but, you know, it's a different matchup. Everyone's not going to just be blowing up everyone, not right away. We need some time for the Ryze, the Cassiopeia, the Ezreal. They're all going to scale up, and, of course, this is going to be a very explosive match once we get to there, but I'm also paying a lot of attention to the jungle and seeing where Kleitos, where Tussle end up. Now, if you guys think that Latin America South can pull out the victory here in game number one, tweet us at LOL Esports, hashtag LASWin. And on the other side, if you think the Japanese Titans are going to take this one, hashtag JPNWin, also at LOL Esports. This is game number one. This is the 5v5 matchup. We've had a lot of fun, but this one is all serious.
Serious indeed. Japan currently undefeated right now. Of course, through proxy did take second because of their 1v1 votes comparatively to Turkey. But this is huge for them. The region recently injected, you know, a lot of structure and support into the scene, bringing in more imported players. The fact that we've got two Koreans on this roster in Dara and Tussle, even though it's kind of the for fun tournament, and they came in here saying we're just gonna have fun.
You guys have been playing without a local server, so they tend to play, you know, on the Korean server up against some of the big boys there. And this is such a meteoric rise of this region. If they can make it to All-Stars through this tournament, it's big for them.
And then on the other side, you have a very similar storyline. Latin America South at IWC and IWCQ. They took second both times. Last time that they were at All-Stars, they did manage to take third. So there wasn't any expectations for the Latin America squads either. So for them to make it out of their group, for them to have this opportunity to look towards the finals, I mean, Japan's standing in their path, but it's also been quite an underdog story.
Absolutely. And it's kind of an interesting mix of players as well. You have a couple of newcomers coming in, right? Like, you've got Plugo, who is very much this kind of rookie player, and you know, they're facing off against some of their more experienced foes as we get the game started and underway.
So I really want to point out where the junglers are starting in the map right now. You've got Kleitos, who's starting on his red buff, and then you have Tussle, who's starting on the top side red buff. Now, what's interesting about Kleitos' pathing is he's actually going to hit level 3 off the Krugs, as will Tussle. But Rek'Sai, we all know her very famous for her ability to bot side gank from blue side in particular. So there aren't a lot of options because he's got an Ezreal and a Janna down there. But I'm kind of curious, you know, is he going to prioritize Scuttlecrab, or is he going to look for this bottom lane gank to try to get this Ezreal and Janna started on the right foot?
He's definitely going to apply some pressure. I don't know how far forward Haredi and Dara will be comfortable playing. You could see a huge amount of chunk damage coming out. Haredi has been pushed back very far, and Wara is just going to keep him at bay here.
And this is what happens when you're punished by picking a melee support like that Alistar. Ezreal, if he can get on the back of the caster creeps, you can see how punishing he'll be with that Mystic Shot in tandem with Janna's E.
Yeah, so Wara is already playing this out very aggressive. Imagine if he'd gone for the Vayne pick as Kleitos moves down towards the bottom and looking to get the counter jungling on. He will steal it away, and Tussle's still up topside.
Yeah, we've already seen some divergence then. The fact that Rek'Sai is just moving a bit quicker through this jungle, although Tussle should be running straight for his blue buff, so if Kleitos can't take this away quickly enough, he's got Smite.
He's going to be coming around the side. Kleitos is able to steal this one away. Tussle actually doesn't know it's happening, but he's going to be chasing down Plugo instead, who gets nailed on the Sonic Wave in an instant flash. Respect out of Plugo.
Hold on, though. Here comes Kleitos.
Oh, right out of the bushes.
Yeah,
and
rocking
hard
flash.
Whoa, that's going to force Tussle to flash away too. Great start here for Kleitos.
But naturally, having Plugo missing both summoners is going to be advantageous for Japan in the end. That was both the Ghost and the Flash on the mid laner. Low mobility. Yes, Ryze has a lot of safety on him because he's fairly tanky. He's hard to lock down, but we'll see if Japan can punish that. And did you catch if Ryze was taking Courage of the Colossus Mastery?
I do not believe so. We saw a couple of Courage of the Colossus Psy, if you will, but it was on Dara, it was on Evie, which is to be expected, and I believe it was just on Kleitos. I didn't see one on Plugo's side, but maybe we'll get that one back up in a minute.
I was just curious. Typically, it's common for Ryze to take Storm Raider Surge or Thunder Lords, but Russia has actually been playing Ryze with Courage of the Colossus on the Mastery.
Well, we used to see Strength of the Ages on him every now and again,
it's
too.
It's pretty disgusting.
Yeah, that is a pretty good mastery. Let's just go with that. Tussle's backing away in River. Scuttlecrab Vision helping out there. Wara and Bear will take their first back. We're only 4 minutes into this game. No serious leads. Up in the top, it has been a wet noodle fight. Star Guardian Poppy up against the Nautilus, who center the Riptide. Hillier's a little bit lower. He shouldn't have been fighting in those minions.
But it's still kind of a tempo advantage for... I don't want to... Yeah, I'm going to call it for Latin America South. And the reason why is because I feel like they got a good back timers off, particularly with their bottom lane. Again, Ezreal, he's not weaker in the initial level one. He's only weaker when he goes back, gets his tier, and then he doesn't have that battle discrepancy. But because they forced it back so early, Ashe is only going to come back with a long sword as opposed to sitting in the lane and competing with, you know, tier versus BF sword. So I still feel like they've got at least a little bit of tempo control here.
Yeah, it's definitely looking good for Latin America South, because when you have a double tier comp, you of course want to like let that kind of ride here. And Kleitos, he's actually getting Tussle's number. He might be able to steal this Scuttlecrab away. He's actually going to move forward, tunnels, and yeah, he does not pick it up, unfortunately, but Tussle is now on top of him. 4 versus level 4, gets the knock-up, unburrowed. And Tussle's not going to take that fight, but Evie was coming in. They were looking to scrap.
Shield coming in, and a lot of people kind of forget the interactions between Rek'Sai and Lee Sin. When he goes to proc in his Q, she can disrupt that if she times her unburrow correctly. It's not as volatile as a matchup that it used to be for Rek'Sai. Gotten a little bit better for Lee Sin.
Yep. Still top-tier junglers, or close enough to it. We've seen quite a lot this season, and that hasn't changed too much, even on the inclusion of the preseason patch. Evie's going to take his back up top. Meanwhile, Heliar had already done that and picks up Abami Cinder. He's going to be doing a little bit more damage to those waves as Teleport gets spent both sides.
Yeah, and this is the big thing. The fact that Heliar uses his Teleport even though he had a window where he could have walked back to lane because the wave was pushing forward. He chooses to force the wave forward, getting the Teleport out of Evie, and I actually think that's more important.
Uh-oh. Plugo, he's got no flash. Syros is on top of him, and he just keeps pounding him into the ground. That's first blood, and Syros just catches Plugo.
Yeah, we'll continue our point on top lane, but that is just Syros. Hold on, though.
Heliar, nice steadfast presence, interrupts.
I was expecting Lee Sin might participate in that since he's sitting at Krugs, but he's fine.
Yeah, Tussle dropped the ball for a sec.
Okay, but originally, the reason why this is good is because the Nautilus level 6 is going to mean more than the Poppy level 6 in terms of how they're going to use their ultimate's bottom, especially with that Ashe. You're going to be much more scared about a targetable CC TPing down there and ruining your bot lane's day. So that's why I think it's smart from Heliar, the captain, to force Evie to use his teleport top to alleviate some of that pressure from the bottom lane.
Right, and it removes a little bit of the tempo. We talked about this mid lane matchup being potentially lopsided. You could see the difference right there. Without his flash, Plugo was a sitting duck inside of the Miasma, and Syros just ripped him in half.
I mean, it doesn't help that you're just, you know, eyeing Cassiopeia straight down the barrel there.
Yeah, didn't even need to use the ultimate. I actually didn't think I had it at that point. Tussle is going to be making his way into
the
jungle once again.
He's looking for deep vision.
Okay, he does get Scryer's Bloom off and spies nothing there. Instead trying to grab a few camps on the other side, but Kleytos is down to the bottom of his jungle.
But this is more punishing than it used to be. Again, the spawn timers were changed, so from 100 seconds to 150. And really what that does is it opens up more windows technically for gank paths, and it tries to nerf a bit more of the power farming junglers just because they can't continuously go back to camps. But Tussle has actually set a trap here. Not only will these be punishing for Kleytos because he has to wait that much longer to get the gold, but he's also about to face check into Lee Sin.
Right into it, gets the unburrow, and now Tussle is the name of the game as he might get caught between him and Plugo. Rune Prison, but in goes Syros. Not need to fight. Every single time Evie is here, this guy has got the game sense.
And that's why they chose to continue with the play anyway. Tussle goes in early, he lays down the triangle vision. Evie has control of the wave, but not control of the wall.
Yeah, he gets banged right into it, and now Kleytos is double teaming with Heliar. Evie's gonna be on the run. Tussle's incoming, he gets the hook, and Steadfast Presence interrupt. Low health bars though, flashing in. Queen's Wrath, who's gonna get the kill here? Evie is incredibly low, but they're just walking away. The Buckler gets it, and Heliar picks up a double with style.
Double kill for the captain there. Now, Heliar and Kleytos will be playing on a team next year, but
whoa, nice flash. Okay, Dara, he was seeing red, but Plugo, just off cooldown, is able to get back under tower.
But Syros did punish the last time the flash was down, so has another opportunity to do so. We think you're cute, Dara.
Always, every time. All right, so he's back to lane now.
That skin is loud.
It is a really loud skin. Okay, let's check in on what's been going on with our bottom lane, or dual lane, I should say. Big lead for Wara, obviously.
Big lead.
But
that's how
the
we're
BF Sword Ash.
Big lead,
yes.
That is a 20 CS lead.
I am very articulate when it comes to talking about leads.
But this is the bigger lead. So, unfortunately for Evie, he loses track of Heliar. Heliar walks into Fog of War. He just shouldn't have... There's no reason to walk up that river right there. Tussle tries to come back, but he's delayed on there. It was actually a really good interrupt from Kleytos. And again, these two guys are going to be on a team. They're going to be on Team Legacy next year in their home region. They're considered the best top laner as well as the best jungler. This tournament was very cool for fans because it was kind of the taste tester, if you will, to see how they would perform together. And yeah, we said that it was all going to be about Wara in the bot lane, but his job is just to sit there and farm. If you can get your top laner ahead, you automatically win bot lane anytime that teleport is up.
Yeah, and that's the funny thing about Heliar is that he's not typically known as a super flashy player, but you got to hand it to him. That play.
Calculating.
Yeah, he turns and smacks the hammer as the buckler's going and just nails that sweet double. So it's 2-1 as we approach 10 minutes into this game and a well-earned 1,000 gold lead for Latin America South.
You just need to think of Heliar as kind of your primary facilitator. His name is the captain. You see that on and off the rift, and now they're setting up another play for him as here comes the Rune Warp.
He comes right in. That's a double team. Evie now is finding himself in a little bit of trouble. Burns his flash, but Heliar just dashes right into the tower. They're going to tank this through, and Plugo picks a kill.
And this is back-to-back games that they prioritize, they first pick Poppy. So Hellier having the confidence that he can take any matchup with that champion and having the execution to perform well on it. It's now Kleytos.
He's even around the backside here.
I mean, he could try to go in for the steal, but he's got War behind him.
I think they might end up giving this one up, but if they can collapse, Tussle is low. There's a teleport. Cassiopeia secures the dragon, but the chase is on. Dara denies the Unburrow, and it looks like Fire going to get away with this one.
There's another teleport available, but Evie's just going to walk up into the top lane. I think it's a mistake for Latin America South to execute on that TP. I think you can serve the cooldown there, so there's now a window for Team Flyer that they can punish Ice here because they have the global advantage with Evie's TP.
So Evie does have the TP though. Let's take a look at that one more time. And up in the top side, Hellier was on Evie, but what he didn't know was that the Ryze was coming for him.
And it's funny too because Plugo just pretty much uses that as a gap closer. He doesn't even dodge any wards with it, but it is enough, but primarily on Hellier, making sure that he's finding these key and crucial stuns. You know, he stunned Evie initially against the wall, finds him that time against the tower.
Critically, Plugo gets the gold for that kill, and since he's been behind so much in CS, this is really beneficial for him. So it'll help him keep pace with Seros right now, who's already completed the Abyssal Scepter. Kleytos up in the top, he's going to clear the control ward away. Spotted, of course, by Evie, and is going to respect that distance.
Yep, also helps reactivate safety vision for Hellier there. The fact that his ward is now means something in that tribe rush.
Yeah, big changes with the control wards here as Dara and Haredi.
This is dangerous.
Will be chasing
the arrow.
The ward. Arrow could come any moment.
Wow.
But respecting the volley, Baron Wara.
So
Wara just
respect.
Goes in again.
And here's the fact, Haredi and Dara have vision and information that Kleytos is on the top side, so they know the jungler isn't there. But the fact that Dara's under half health and just how much respect they're giving to Wara and Bear right now, I thought for sure it was going to be the arrow.
And it tells the story, too, to Latin America South that Tussle is not around because they could be playing with that information, they could be playing much more confidently, but Haredi and Dara are not looking to tango with Wara and Bear.
Someone who is looking to tango, though.
Yeah, Seros is always gunning for something.
He's got complete control over the mid lane, which means that they now have the advantage of going what I'm going to call the Silk Road. Basically, you start out on the Raptor camp, and it feeds all the way down into bot lane. If you secure this with vision or you can control this path, you pretty much get access to Dragon bot lane tower as well as these setup plays.
Oh boy, and here's why it's called the Silk Road, because there's a lot of trade going on. Tussle kicks Kleytos right into Dara. Bear's incoming.
Here's the
arrow. It's going to land, and Kleytos is a sitting duck. Bear gets the heal way too late. Tussle picks a kill for himself, and just like that, the LGL have equalized on kills.
It's not done yet. Dara does have ultimate. They could look to dive this. Wara is in a lot of trouble.
Wara might think he can go in and finish off already.
He's trying to chip them individually, yeah. And no one's pushing the wave into the tower. Dara has to get in position and tank this for his team. He might have bought himself enough time.
Oh, man. Dara goes in for the headbutt. Pull of exhaust is on. The flash is burn flash.
He dodged one.
They can't get the lead.
He dodged two.
But War is still going down, and they juggle the aggro effectively.
Okay. Took a little bit too long,
though. Kleytos, what are you doing? Oh, my God. He gets the flash. Three-man Unburrow. Tussle is going to flash away. Smites the Krugs. And Kleytos is just running now. He tried. I'll give him that.
Wara with his best fancy footwork can't catch them. Oh, wait.
Bear's going to try, though.
Look at Hellier.
On. Hellier is just marching down the bottom. Flash, tornado. They've got Dara, who's running away. The auto will finish the job, and Haredi is going to get safe under tower. But is it going to be safe? Hellier is looking to come
in. Oh, he's running in.
For a heroic charge.
Good night, sweet
Steadfast
prince.
Steadfast presence, and goodbye, Ash. Auto attack finishes the kill, and Kleytos tanks it.
Okay, even though Wara doesn't get any assists throughout that entire exchange, I'm giving him MVP of this play. He lasted so long. So initially, it's a play set up by LJL. They execute on it brilliantly. They find Kleytos. They manage to take him down. Oh.
And that's all we got time for, because there's a flash rune prison.
Another wall.
Seros gets knocked right into the wall. He did not have any summoners to burn. And
see
Hellier winds up the Poppycopter to deny that teleport effectiveness.
And there was that window where the LJL actually could play cross-map globally better than Latin America South. But joke's on them, because Hellier beat them to the punch, walking all the way down to get involved on the back half of that play.
Speaking of getting involved, Hellier has had ridiculous kill participation this game. Even though he's had, you know, a misfire on a teleport, he has done so well. And Wara, down in this bottom lane, looks to secure first tower blood here. And they know Kleytos is here. Haredi, they have to respect this. The damage from Wara is too real. They're going to get it. So 15 minutes into this game, they're going to pull ahead in the lead, and Plugo's still taking pot shots mid.
I mean, I'm going to take some pot shots on the desk right now, because I know that talking backstage, everyone's like, ah, Japan's got this. This is an easy 2-0. And I've been watching these games. So I was like, I understand that they lost in assassin mode. But this team looked so good.
Oh, dear. Plugo. As we say it, the gang squad comes for him.
But this is perfect. Latin America South, where they're strong, is in their macro play. How they identify the objectives, where they need to be on the map, and moving to the correct positions. LJL are so good at their mechanics. They're great at skirmishing. They're great at pulling off these little plays here. So we finally, it's like replay
now
after replay.
Now we get to show it again, because you're right. Wara just lasted so long and burned so much from this enemy team. He gets his flash off. Okay, but look at how much they invest
he
to
dodges
kill
him. Both the Q as well as the volley through where he positions behind his creep wave, and it takes so long to kill him that his team is able to clean up on the back half.
And Kleidos died at the start of that fight, by the way. That's how long this whole engage was.
But the important thing is, again, the individual decision-making and the team decision-making from Latin America South compensate for the fact that they may not have the flashiest mechanics to keep up with the brute force strength of the LJL. Because Tussle, Dara, Seros, these guys are superstars when it comes to 1v1s.
I will tell you what, though, when you see these two styles match up, this is some good League of Legends. Heliar just knocks Haredi right into that wall. Kleidos perfect tanking. And yeah, it is macro versus the micro decisions, and it has been bloody. 6-5 in kills now. And nobody's even eyeballing that dragon, by the way. Heliar gets some vision down here, but that's about it.
Well, when it comes down to macro play, now we have to look at what the summoners are available to us. The fact that Heliar now has the teleport advantage over Evie, and again, the fact that Kleidos got his hands on the Rek'Sai. I'm telling you, if you are in a 5v5 on Summoner's Rift against Latin America South, Kleidos cannot have that champion. He is too influential on it. He is the shot caller of this team, and you cannot give him that much global pressure.
And that's the best part about this, too. Normally, in a regular traditional best of three or best of anything, you can see what your opponent does and ban that out the next game, change up your pick and ban strats. You can't do that in game number two. They're playing assassin mode.
And that's where they might fall down, as they did the first time.
Well, they have to win this game first if they want to make that a tie situation, but no speculating about that from us. And just take a look across the board as we're 17 and a half odd minutes into this game. Who's looking really pretty right now? Heliar, of course, working his way towards more defensive items. He has the Swifties, and that's come in so handy. Evie on the other side has done the same. But I think the real big difference is this mid. Still been a 20 CS discrepancy, but you can see Plugo looking a lot more comfortable, and he's also not opting to lane against Seros for the time being.
It's kind of like what their damage sets are going to be as soon as we break out into these 5v5s. Wara and Plugo are still kind of waiting for their tiers to take off and that full kind of mid-peaking itemization to come online for Ezreal and Ryze. But things do get a little bit hairy as we start looking to late game. You know, if Wara doesn't land all of his skill shots, he doesn't have the easy, consistent damage that Haredi does on the Ashe, things can go sideways because you're dealing with Cassiopeia and Ashe and Nautilus. A lot of those champions are going to do a lot of damage.
It's like you said in pick and ban, it's all about stacking that CC up and nailing a target, but it has been hard to catch Plugo. I think Wara is definitely somebody to look for. This is a guy that will always E in. He's like the opposite of Wei Zhao. Just giving you a little throwback there, I know.
The memories.
Yeah, Plugo's going to take out this tower, though. It is nice to see Latin America South shoving their advantage and able to nail down a few more turrets, because they can, pound for pound right now, outplay if they match the lanes up correctly.
And again, it's about abusing the lane assignments. As soon as we prioritize taking down first tower bottom, we suddenly pick up our bot lane. They're now in the mid lane. That frees up Ryze to abuse the individual lane assignments up in top, and suddenly we've got 2 towers to 0 in favor of Latin America South.
Yeah, good news for LJL, though, is they're able to secure a little bit more vision. Scuttlecrab being taken away. Dara is going to find Bear and Wara.
Tussle is flirting with danger. It's my kind of Lee Sin player.
Oh, he's looking pretty good in this game. 3-1-1's a pretty respectable score, and all the same, Tussle, he just wants to fight, but he has a window of effectiveness. He needs to start using it.
This is scary, though. This is like LJL's perfect. You can see Ashe and Nautilus. They're rushing here. They want to go for the fight.
Ashe here. Oh, it's going to nail Wara, and they pinball him to his death. And now the fight is on. Bear and Plugo trying desperately to run, but Heliar has joined the fray, and he charges right into Dara. The Poppycopter winds up. They know they can't take this fight, and they have got to bail out. One kill so far, but back to the safety of tower they go.
That could have been worse, and it might get worse.
Why is he still fighting? The hook's going to land. They're going to keep going here. Evie takes a lot of damage, return damage, I should say, but Kleidos is not healthy enough. He has to leave. Heliar is still trying to defend this tower. This might be LJL's first.
No, they survived it. They weathered the storm. The LJL will not be able to find any sort of counter push on taking down the mid tower. That was super risky from Latin America South. They saw the chip damage on the mid tower. They thought that they had a big enough window to push it down. Tussle might find a table scraps, if you will, of taking away the red buff, but... Yeah.
It was a little bit greedy of Kleitos to try and take that after the fight, but let's see it all again because Tussle waiting in the wings set this all up.
But again, the most important thing here is the fact that the tower is so low. That's why they're taking this gamble, because you know that LJL's only response is to make a big, crazy flanking play, and they have all of the CC, like that Ash Arrow, like the Nautilus Ultimate, to pull that off. Unfortunately, Wara takes the Ice Arrow straight to the teeth. But fortunately for the rest of the team, Plugo is able to disengage them.
Yeah, I was surprised they didn't just all fall down at that point, because Wara, I mean, you could put a bowling strike sound in front of that animation and just watch it go. That was an insta-kill. They got the tower for it. So they have 3 towers to 0. LJL have not been able to find that gold, but you know, this is a guy playing Blue Ezreal. He's going to want to kite back a little bit more in the future.
Yeah, we've seen a lot more priority towards the Trinity Force Ezreal, especially because, yeah, you have the Ryze, but again, Plugo plays more as kind of a mage supportive control player, so expect to see him use Ryze like that as opposed to kind of like a faker Ryze where he's forward, he's in your face, he's challenging you.
Oh, we've seen this before.
I don't think they're going to be able
to
get away with it.
They launch themselves over, a la CIS style, and
they stop moving.
Latin America South don't have a clue. They did not get the Rek'Sai Tremor Sense.
But they need to get Cassiopeia over there.
Ah, it was a nice try, guys. A little early to attempt. It's only 21 and a half minutes.
They can do it as long as Seros is there, especially because he has the blue buff. Again, never underestimate Cassiopeia's epic monster shred, but unfortunately he wasn't part of the crew that got over with that blast cone.
Yeah, a nice attempt, but now they're wise to it. Again, let's take a look as we have a momentary lull in the action. 6-6, 22 minutes in. Bear's going to clear the control ward out of the back of Baron Pit. And there's a dragon apiece, but Latin America South have the objective-based one. As you can see, pings for LJL are looking for the top side. They still have yet to find a tower in this game.
But they need to understand that the LJL, the most important objective for them on the map, is going to be that mid tower. And they have, again, the options on their composition to break it. Heredi really should just be standing in Fog of War as opposed to matching up across from Ryze and just trying to find one of those cheeky arrows down mid lane to help the LJL break that.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to be an arrow pod for a little while at least. He's very far behind Wara.
But he's out of position. That's the thing. He's clearing side lanes, and yes, you never want your Cassiopeia and your Ashe in the same lane because then they're denying farm and resources away from each other.
But the safe zones are disappearing. I mean, you could see the vision creep from Latin America South that's giving them dragon control here with 10 seconds on the next Drake to come up. And even though Tussle is doing his best to clear this out, they've got to be super careful if they want to try to contest for things like this.
Tussle
Plugo
is about
is to
walk
top,
into a lot of people.
Yeah, he's going to need that Banshee's
Bale. Back.
There we go. They're actually going to start this dragon off, but instantly Bear and Kleitos are right on their tail, and so is Heliar.
But Plugo doesn't have teleport, so it is a 4v5 if Evie TP's down.
Yeah, and you can see Heredi already running for it. They are going to give this Drake up. The Miasma laid out the carpet that they didn't want to cross, so LJL do manage to secure themselves a little bit extra regeneration out of combat.
And again, now it's suddenly Latin America South that have the poor lane assignments.
Evie was abusing the tower and the Riptide! He can't quite close the distance, the shield. Plugo nearly bought it. That was so close.
He took a couple of extra tower shots.
I mean, he got an assist with the tower. That happens. Okay, Heliar wants to fight here, and he's going to bang Tussle up against the wall. Steadfast presence.
Arrow?
Ash Arrow. He's going to sidestep it here. It just goes right through the uprights of Team Ice, and now they're going to try to turn this fight. But Wara, he almost got caught himself before he...
Someone's getting in the wall.
He's backwards. I think the Poppy is
making
the target right now. Kleitos is right onto Tussle. Meanwhile, Evie front tanking. Heredi is trying to make the fight happen. Heliar couldn't quite get onto the wall, but they do get a flash unburrow. Kleitos is getting knocked back into this one, and Bear's on the front. Tussle manages to find the fight before falling down. However, Wara is able to shut him down, and Seros is going on a rampage looking for Heliar. He needs another Twin Fang. Can he secure it? The Ash is able to pick that one up, and Dara now has gone in. This has gone pear-shaped for Latin America South, but Plugo's coming to the rescue. There's a lot of low health bars. And now Wara's gone down. It's going to be Seros. This fight just keeps on going. It's a 3v1. Plugo, what can he even do here? He's trying to sidestep, and no Rune Prison. He's going to get it now, and he is so low under tower. He gets one. He gets two. Oh, my goodness. Talk about making the best out of a bad situation, Frost.
Tower gets MVP for both teams right now. Latin America South, they've been outmaneuvering Japan across the map, but when it comes toe-to-toe, when it comes 5v5, Japan looked really good for a second until they tried to overdive.
They pushed their luck so hard on that, and Plugo, massive props for for baiting them in and taking down two before getting equalized. We got to see that again. Here's how the whole thing started.
Okay, first and foremost, Hellier has his ultimate the entirety of the fight, which is why Team Ice are so confident and continuing to chase. Because, like, we still have our primary disengage. We still have the Monsoon. We have the Poppy ultimate. So we're free to kind of continue to chip away at them. If they get too close, we'll reset the fight.
This is 4v5, too.
Yeah, because Pluto's not here. Look at on your map. You can see he's actually running from base. So the problem is that the Cassiopeia ultimate locks up multiple people, and suddenly those disengage ultimates don't mean anything. Bear barely got the Monsoon off before he dies. And again, Hellier has had his ultimate the entire time, and he dies without using it.
Yeah, he starts the windup, but then they just instantly pick him away. And Wara, look at him just trying to kite this whole thing out. But Plugo, he comes in, they instantly exhaust him. Wara somehow stays alive for a little while, and it becomes a 1v3. I mean, that was just wacky.
Problem was, is then they don't manage the correct tower aggro juggle. And speaking of that, I guess we're fighting again.
Yeah, I was going to say, is this still the replay? I think this is a completely different one, but it looks the same. Dara is getting chunked low, but he throws on his ultimate to stay alive. Hellier finds Tussle in the back as Bear gets a three-man knockup. We just keep on bumping around. Saros from around the side gets his ult, but Hellier targets on him.
And War is in the back line.
Chased around the back, a double kill over to Plugo, and they are cleaning house on the LGL right now. A double kill for Hellier. They finish the job. One for Wara. That's the ace, and it's Baron time.
And it suddenly looks so much better for Latin America South when they're able to use their Monsoon and their Poppy ultimate effectively right there. The fact that Wara got a hold of both Saros and Haredi in the back line, Japan just, their tanks failed them.
Yeah, this whole tournament, we have seen the power of fire, but ice is not melted just yet. 27 minutes into this game, it's a big gold lead, and we're going to start to see this fight.
All eyes really need to be on Wara. Now, he's sitting in mid lane right now, but he's going to join the back half of this fight, and he's going to do a lot of chip damage to Saros. And Saros, again, is so important for Japan. Not only is he the Cassiopeia, but he's their best mid laner. He's the Faker of Japan. If he goes down, things go sideways.
Yeah, he gets chased by Wara pretty much this whole fight if you see off screen
this
in the river, but this is
2v1 down in the river. Look at Saros, half health, takes the Ezreal ultimate. Now Easy's gonna come up behind him and just destroys him, obliterates him from the fight.
Wara just trains on him the whole time, and Hellier at the end just kind of smashes him into the wall and takes the kill away. But yeah, at this point, it doesn't matter how tanky Evie is, the rest of his team's falling down around, and that Monsoon comes up clutch.
Yes.
It's good reactions.
I love the cheers.
These guys are happy to be here. Talk about
they're loud
LGL having
us.
Fun. Yeah, Latin America South, they're having some fun too. How about winning this game so far? We're getting 28 minutes into the game. It's a big gold lead right now. It's creeped up to about 6K. There's another Mountain Drake spawning in a minute and a half. All they got to do on Latin America South side is just keep on pushing these tower leads. LGL still have yet to pick one up.
I'm telling you, people were saying, you know, Turkey, they've got the best macro strategy in this tournament from the one 5v5 that we've seen. I'm like, no, I think it's Latin America South. Kleitos just looked so good on this Rek'Sai. He's known throughout his region as being the best shot caller in the region by the community and his peers alike. You can see that he's always going to be the first person into a team fight. He's always going to be setting up a wave. And again, that's why I think Rek'Sai is such a coveted pick for him. It allows him so much control over so many different assets of the game.
But not only that, Hellier is also doing exactly what he did against Southeast Asia. And he's just come up really big. With the exception of the fight where he dies with his ult still available, he's constantly threatening, and he just fits the puzzle piece that the team needs to finish these fights. And here we go again.
They
can't actually use it, but they got the tower.
They have the right idea more often than not. Where they fall down is in mis-execution. But as long as you're still doing the right thing, better than doing the wrong thing than executing on it well. The thing is when Japan win fights, they either overcommit and the fight means nothing or the victory means nothing, or they win fights and they're not able to translate that into objectives. You think about the red buff bot skirmish. They technically won that fight, but what did it mean for them? They weren't able to take a tower off of it. They weren't able to siege a dragon or to take a baron.
Speaking of dragon, now that Latin America South have got so much vision control and have forced LGL back into the base, that one is an easy, uncontested take, and they get even more damage to knock down the objectives, and Japan's running out of towers here.
But they have the ones that still matter, and they have a lot of wave clear. It's still always going to be very scary to dive, both in Alistar, Nautilus, and Cassiopeia. They have great wave clear in the Cassie as well as the Ash. So they're going to, Latin America South are going to need these two mountain dragons and probably another rotation of Baron before they feel really confident pushing into Japan's inhibitor line.
Yeah, it's true, but Japan are definitely going to have to play a lot more conservative and not try to push too far out of their base and outside of their vision zone.
But what this means is even though Japan are behind in the game by close to 10K, that they have kind of this six-minute window between the next kind of Baron spawn. It's probably closer to seven at this point because Baron's still alive. Of turning the game around, you know, setting up their vision, getting another chance, finding that another pick. And again, they have so many tools to do that, like the Ash Arrow and their comp. So Japan are still very much in this, as long as they don't lose here. Maybe give up an inhibitor. I don't think they'll need to if things look scary, but they've got another 10 minutes left in them to turn this game around.
And a lot of it's going to be off the back of Saros. I think, like you said earlier, he needs to basically be the one who's dishing out the consistent damage in the fight. It's not Haredi. Haredi's going to be setting up those engages. If they can properly protect Saros with Tussle, with Evie, they can win fights still.
But ultimately, I actually think that means the responsibility's on Tussle, on Dara, on Haredi, and Saros just needs to be that follow-up. But Haredi with that Ash Arrow, you know, we said that this is a weakness that Latin America South could exploit in the individual matchup. He needs to step up now, and he needs to find that key arrow on Bora, on Plugo. He found it once.
Yeah, you can see that the LJL are definitely going for that protect your big carry kind of build. You can see the redemption's been finished on Dara right now. Obviously, he has his own Seraphs. Saros does to, you know, keep himself alive a little bit longer, but you got to be really, really careful and save your summoner spells for those big situations. And we'll see how it happens as Haredi's trying to defend topside. They are being pulled apart by Latin America South.
They're just pushing farm into them right now. Again, I still think this game probably has between 10 and 15 minutes left in it. Japan are very much still in this, especially if they get a good 5v5. And really, Latin America South are playing the split push pressure game. They don't want to commit to one thing because, again, diving is still going to be very scary. It's just, you know, find the chip damage where you can. If you can get a pick, take it. But slowly pulling them apart at the seams as opposed to just bashing them in.
Yep. Although Wara,
he's good,
cannot dodge the dredge line forever, but he does get out of range, so there's no retaliation available. Heliarx keeps on pushing the wave in the bottom side, but they've really done their job up top when they just keep pecking away at this turret. But you can see that the LJL is responding very quickly. They realize this is the choice target.
Because Latin America South need to keep LJL within the confines of their base. We're now on the 1 minute 30 warning for Baron, and the longer that they can keep the LJL trapped in here, the less time the LJL have to kind of set up a counter defense. You know, setting up their vision around Baron, trying to make it advantageous for them to contest that objective.
I definitely want to go back to Heliar for just a minute, because he's been so critical to denying a lot of these fights. You see every single time Tussle gets anywhere near him, he throws in the Steadfast Presence. He knows he can deny the big kick backwards. That's why we haven't seen Tussle be able to make these hero Lee Sin plays this game, as Heliar gets the windup.
They're going to siege this.
Teleport. They might be able to cancel it. They will, in fact, do that. And Dara now is in the thick of things, and he is running out of health very fast. He might have the Unbreakable Will on, but it may not matter. The Redemption is enough to keep him alive, but now the Inhibitor is under fire. Saros threatening, chasing them away. They do not want to commit, but they got what they came for, and Plugo gets hooked. Tussle is looking for the kick backwards. He finds it onto Plugo, but they can't finish him off. He's going to flash into the monsoon. Haredi finishes the job with an auto attack, and now Evie is looking to make this bigger. Tussle takes out Bear, finishes the job, and Kleidos is going to fall. The LJL have done it. They managed to get a fight they need here, and Dara goes in. A big flash headbutt. Pulv, a double kill for Saros, and it is only Heliar left.
Disaster for Latin America South. The thing that I'm looking at right now is the fact that Baron is 15 seconds from spawning. Heliar, yes, he's still alive. Yes, he has his teleport. But you're looking at 30 seconds before Kleitos is up. Does he even have any tunnels? He'd have to walk from spawn.
Oh, wow. Evie just gets pushed back. Heliar still wants to try and deny this, but there are such long death timers. 15 seconds on Plugo. Bear is the only one
here. He has
his
ultimate. He can knock them off the Baron.
He finished this, though. Saros is tanking right now. The windup is there. The Poppycopter is going to send two flying. Dara and Haredi, they can't finish this on their own. Heliar looks like he may have done it, and he's chasing down Haredi. Look at the damage that this Poppy is pushing out, but the rest of the team has arrived. He might have just bought enough time. He goes down, but guess what? You got to shred through the Guardian Angel, and meanwhile, Kleidos has ulted back to mid. They stopped it.
Disaster for Latin America South, but the hero that they need, the captain up in the top lane, Heliar. What a great Poppy ultimate. The fact that he disengages the two correct members of getting the Cassiopeia and the Lee Sin out of the pit so that Ash is left to tank the Baron, single-handedly saved them.
100% of the way, and now it is Latin America South that have control of the Baron pit. The LJL may have won a fight, but they still could not get anything. They've still got no towers, Frostcurrent. We're 35 minutes in.
It's fine, because at this point, if they win the Baron, if they win the Elder Drake, if they win a big 5v5, they're strong enough that that zero tower will automatically become three towers.
Probably. I hope so, because it looks like they're allergic to him otherwise. LGL is going to try and force this Baron. Look, they've actually caught him out of position. This could be a good for them.
Here's the scary thing, is how quickly they'll burn this. Okay, they've got the TP.
Waiting for Heliar. Okay, looks like they can try to take this fight. Heliar a little bit low, and he does not want to commit, but they find him in. Plugo's around the backside. They just need to buy some time for him, and he knocks a bunch out before he goes down. Plugo looking for the flank, straight on to Saros, who ults away, but Saros has managed to stay alive. Tussle has found Plugo to finish the job, and all of a sudden, the teamfighting prowess of the LJL just comes up huge. Wara is kiting and running and trying to keep himself alive. Tussle has not gone down just
yet. Gone.
Wara is actually keeping them all on the back foot.
The arcade shifted Alistair's animation of the headbutt.
You have got to be kidding me. And he's going to rejoin Bear in the mid. Now there's a teleport. These fights just do not stop.
This is hilarious. Okay, I hope we get a replay of that team fight, because there's one person that I want to point out in particular. Kleidos, are you crazy?
Apparently.
He's nuts.
Yeah, they brought Baron Wara here. They're shredding through this. Are they going to trade an Elder for Baron?
This is still nuts.
There's a massive mini-wave topside. This is so dangerous for Japan.
Okay, so we don't often get to see these types of trades happen. But the problem is the wave clear on Latin America South is still fairly weak. It's a little bit better just because Ezreal decided to go for the Iceborne Gauntlet. But before we get to that, I want everyone to pay attention to Plugo here, because Plugo is really what cost Latin America South this fight. And better than that, the fact that Team Fire know how to team fight so well. Sarah sitting just right in the back on that Cassiopeia, protecting Heredia, knowing his responsibility. Plugo finally comes around the side to get involved in the fight, but it's too little too late. For so long, that Ryze wasn't doing anything, contributing nothing to that fight. As soon as he walks in, he just gets blown up, and it's simply through the mechanical prowess of Wara, especially that arcane shift there, that Latin America South are able to get any sort of trade in that engagement.
Yeah, no kidding. All right, back into the live game. Look at the damage that fight. Wara was the reason they didn't lose it all, and Bear, he might lose his health right now.
No. The only number you have to pay attention to is 367. Ryze did less damage than Janna.
Not great that time around, but this may be a different story as Evie gets caught and has to tank a lot of damage. They've knocked him into the wall, but they can't finish him off. Redemption is coming up huge for both of these teams this game. That's Dara's spent, and that's a half-health inhibitor. Baron minions versus double Mountain Drake Elder.
Dragon changes did come through on 6.23, so they've got a bit more room to work with on this buff.
They're not going to go for it, though. Japan have defended. It's such a tense moment when you're working with these two big, powerful buffs.
I think they're effectively going to neutralize each other. That would have been bad.
Yeah, Wara has had some of the quickest reaction timings that I have seen in a long time. Very impressive play from this guy. Even when the fights look lost, he's able to still come up with something. He almost got two picks there.
And he wasn't initially the guy voted in, and now I'm just like, Latin America South, why not? This guy's so good.
He's a rookie. This was his first competitive split in the summer of 2016. And yeah, he was the third voted guy. Well, I bet they're pretty happy he's here now.
I would be. They built the first time they were on 5v5, they built a composition around his Vayne. He shows up in assassin mode. You know, true, they played an AD carry. He is the actual AD carry.
Yeah, this is kind of crazy stuff. Excuse me, I was talking about Plugo, my bad. Wara is the guy that roll swap from being a mid laner, so there's your mechanics.
It's still hard to roll swap from being a mid laner and then be recognized as one of the best AD carries in your region.
Yeah, it's a big deal for him. And I think he's shown, like, you can look at Vayne and like, okay, a Vayne game, he goes off, they did protect the comp, and that's still impressive. But you think, okay, does he have any other tricks? He looks so good on this Ezreal. It makes you wonder why he even bothered with the Vayne in the first place.
Kleidos was looking like he was wanting a flank.
He was just taking a scenic tour. We're 40 minutes just about into this game. This is one of the longest we have had in this tournament so far.
The thing is again, the Elder Drake and the Baron buff really neutralized themselves as far as, you know, the objectives that would fall down on the map. So again, we're now in another scenario where the LJL might be able to chip away this tower. I would certainly give it away if I was Latin America South.
They need the gold at this point. Let them have it. deposit into their bank accounts, it's going to start earning interest for them.
But this means that we're now looking towards the next respawn of these epic monsters. Although Rune Warp is pulling Plugo somewhere.
I'm not sure where. He just disappeared.
I think he just went.
Ah, he's back to mid.
Back in the mid lane.
He juked us both.
Juked the observers.
The question is, do Latin America South want to fight here? Because they seem 50-50. Tussle is not with the LJL team.
It's more so that they have the inside track on the mid lane, so they're forcing the LJL to respond. They may actually be able to just burn through the tower, depending on how much damage they just brute force due to it. Again, the tower reduction is coming through right now because they don't have any creeps.
No, and Heliar narrowly dodges away from the dredge line of Evie, who's chasing down. Clearly, the LJL want this fight, and with Tussle rejoining them, the 5v5 could get hairy.
But it's cute little things like this, Latin America South, you know, showing that they understand how to play with creep waves and different pressure points on the map. They understand that this is still an incredibly terrifying 5v5 across from them, especially when they're that far forward up a lane, and Asher would be very punishing. But just constantly trying to cheat their way across the map, just creating these small advantages by getting to a wave faster, by setting up a big push faster.
Yeah, and it's evened out so much over the course of this game, because we saw Latin America South getting out to a flying start, really, and winning in every lane but the mid. But now that you're getting close to max items, it just doesn't matter anymore.
I mean, what put them in this position, this was their game to win, but they got greedy, they got impatient, and they overstayed when trying to put down that top inhibitor that really allowed Japan to get their foot back into this game. Otherwise, this should have been done. This was a 10K gold lead for Latin America South, and now we're to the point in the game where the gold discrepancy doesn't matter at all. Not only has it almost completely closed or been cut in half, but everyone's on their core itemization, everyone's approaching six items, so Latin America South, you had it, and you gave it away.
Yeah, and I think the Baron is going to be a big tipping point in this game. Once again, it's a minute and a half out. You can see that Latin America South just continually trying to push those waves and keep the vision control on their side of the map. But there's a few deep wards here for the LJL. They just keep on moving in and grabbing a bit back for themselves. Such a close game with 17-16 in the kill department. And the fights have definitely been going Japan's way.
This is where control wards get pretty broken, however. The fact that all of our ward spots have been pretty much eaten away by different ingredients or completed item builds. That you're pretty much entirely reliant on just the support's sight stone, as well as your three control wards that they can hold, and the fact that it also cancels out vision from sight wards. This is kind of where the control wards were meant to shine, is in these late game scenarios where your vision options are limited due to slot space. So keep your eyes on how Bear will maneuver those, and if they're going to set them up to deny Baron.
And Bear has come up very, very clutch. We talk about his macro decision making, but in those fights, you have to give this man credit. He's clearly in his element on the Janna, and he has had some really, really, really big tornadoes.
Bear is here because he's lovable.
Yes.
That's
gives you warm fuzzies.
No, that's why he's a fan favorite support. He's not recognized as, you know, being the best support in his region.
He is a very experienced player though, and again, he's on a comfortable champion.
Definitely,
like the Janna.
Well, obviously, to be a popular player in your region, typically you are a veteran, you've been around for a long time, but everyone that I've talked to and like, okay, so tell me about Bear. They're like, he's just really lovable.
Well, they certainly are loving him right now, and now Tussle is caught in the middle of it all. And he gets his Guardian Angel popped. Heliar is trying to send everybody back, and now without friends, Tussle's gone down, and Bear picks that kill up for himself, so he's got claws too.
That's the jungler, and maybe more. Saros is now in trouble.
Realm Warp, and Saros is isolated from his team. They're just pushing him apart. He's going to flash. He's going to burn everything, and he can't get enough. Shut down. Wara has found him, and now it is 2-0. Heliar is buying all the time in the world. He flashes, he dashes, Evie gets the knockup, but Heliar is standing firm, and this could be the end for the LJL in game one.
They've lost their primary disengage, and it's really only Heredi available that can clear the waves. I think they're about to get smothered out. I think Latin America South are taking game one.
Those two dragons are coming in handy right now, and Heliar keeps on tanking all the damage. Redemption coming up already. Forced back to Fountain, and it's only Evie who's standing outside of it. Plugo might get caught here, but they just don't give a damn anymore. They're on the tower, but they do lose Plugo. Teleport on Heliar to try and keep the minion alive and tanking. They finish the last tower, but Tussle is about to come up, and it is focus on the champions, but they gotta hit the Nexus. They're gonna do it. 44 and a half in, and it was a nail biter. But Latin America South with a win.
They had control.